Macmillan Audio presents Defender in Chief by John Yoo, narrated for you by James Edward Thomas.
Dedicated to my mother, Sookhee Yoo, M.D. Introduction. The Constitution has become the sword for Democrats who want Donald Trump removed from office. In her December 5, 2019 speech formally calling for articles of impeachment, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi declared, "The president's actions have seriously violated the Constitution, especially when he says and acts upon the belief Article 2 says, I can do whatever I want." No. She portrayed Trump's actions as a fundamental threat. His wrongdoing strikes at the very heart of our Constitution, a separation of powers, three co-equal branches, each a check and balance on the other. A republic, if we can keep it, said Benjamin Franklin. Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer agreed. If we don't reckon with President Trump's persistent transgressions, the very foundation of this great republic is at risk. The president kept pushing and pushing and pushing the constitutional envelope. Finally, the president's conduct made an impeachment inquiry unavoidable. Democratic critics have made violations of the Constitution a regular part of their litany attacking the Trump presidency for breaking the law. Hillary Clinton took to the airwaves in September 2019 to dismiss President Trump as an illegitimate president and a corrupt human tornado, and to declare that he knows he stole the 2016 election. Her 2016 vice presidential candidate shared the view of Trump's unconstitutional conduct. President Trump's decision to launch airstrikes against Syria without Congress's approval is illegal, and, absent a broader strategy, it's reckless, Senator Tim Kaine said in 2018 after U.S. missile strikes against the Assad regime. Liberal Harvard Law professor Lawrence Tribe, perhaps the most distinguished constitutional law scholar of his generation, barely gave Trump time to adjust his desk chair before declaring the Constitution violated. I wouldn't say he's bumping into the Constitution. He's crashing through it, Tribe said on January 31, 2017. Tribe, who joined a lawsuit against Trump over, of all things, the Emoluments Clause, declared, "I've never seen anything like this in my lifetime." This book will explain why Trump has not become the Constitution's destroyer, but instead its most unlikely defender. Rather than a sword, the Constitution has become Trump's shield. Even though he had not had any previous government or military office or public policy experience, Trump has defended the constitutional text, structure, and design for an independent, vigorous executive. Trump has fought off the efforts of progressives who have wanted to revolutionize our constitutional order by vesting ever more power in a permanent bureaucracy of virtually limitless authority, and to undermine institutions designed to channel and balance pure majority rule. Whether consciously or by following his own political incentives, which the Constitution itself creates, as we will see, Trump has become a far more stout defender of our original governing document than his critics have. Should he win a second term, Trump's exercise of presidential power to protect the nation's security, slim the federal government, and appoint originalist judges may engineer a radical return of our constitutional system to its founding roots. If friends had told me on January 21, 2017, that I would write a book on Donald Trump as a defender of the Constitution, I would have questioned their sanity. I had not voted for Trump in the 2016 primary or general elections. his many personal and professional flaws, including his bankruptcies, sexual scandals, crude and cruel language, repelled me. I saw him as a populist, even a demagogue, who had not prepared for the heavy responsibilities of the presidency. My study of the separation of powers and my time in the three branches of government led me to worry that Trump would test, evade, or even violate the Constitution. And let us just say that the University of California at Berkeley, my place of work for nearly three decades, did not foster an environment for Trump supporters. Boy, was I wrong. Trump campaigns like a populist, but governs like a constitutional conservative. Throughout American history, presidents who believe they represent a popular movement have sought to overturn established constitutional practices. Thomas Jefferson, Andrew Jackson, Abraham Lincoln, Franklin Roosevelt, and Ronald Reagan did not just win the presidency with broad support, they sparked revolutions in constitutional understandings. They aggressively wielded presidential power to advance their political agendas against a resistant establishment. But these greatest American presidents succeeded because their circumstances demanded the vigorous exercise of executive power. I worried that Trump would draw upon the great reservoir of presidential power during times that did not need it. After Trump won the Republican primaries, he gave traditional Republicans a lot to like. Tax cuts and deregulation would jumpstart the economy, which had recovered listlessly after the Great Recession. Appointing conservative judges would end the cultural wars in the courts and return social questions to the democratic federal political process. Recognizing the rising threat of China, he would rebuild a military hollowed out by years of sequesters and spending caps, one that had played defense on the new battlefields of cyber, drones, and space. But he also broke with Republican orthodoxies on generous immigration and international trade, where union-led Democrats had the longer record of hostility toward the free movement of people, goods, and capital. While I never signed the never-Trumper letters that freely circulated among former Bush national security officials, I could not bring myself to support the nominee of my party because I felt that his rashness could lead to a foreign policy disaster, even if he were to appoint a conservative Supreme Court or cut taxes. In the first few months of the Trump presidency, I even wrote an op-ed in the New York Times to warn about executive power run amok. I have consistently defended the presidential power, such as the right to wage war unilaterally, of George W. Bush, in whose administration I served, but of Barack Obama and Bill Clinton, too. But President Trump's first moves gave even me pause. During the campaign, he had displayed little knowledge of the Constitution. Recall that he thought the Constitution had 11 or 12 articles. It only has 7. He claimed the unilateral right to build a wall along the Mexican border without congressional funding or authorization. His first executive order banning travel from Muslim nations violated the religion clauses of the First Amendment. He threatened to terminate the North American Free Trade Agreement, which takes the form of a law passed by Congress rather than a treaty. Even Alexander Hamilton, our nation's most ardent proponent of executive power, would be worried by now, I suggested. Trump is disrupting the political system, perhaps for good. He has transformed presidential speeches, for example, from formal addresses into stream-of-consciousness rallies. He speaks directly to the American people through social media, randomly calls into Fox News shows, and engages the press in off-the-cuff spontaneous arguments. Trump's direct talk to the American people has banished the formal Oval Office address and press conference to the dustbin of history. Thankfully, Trump has brought the combative politics that he brandished on the campaign trail into the Oval Office. He boasted about the size of his inauguration crowds, refused to release his tax returns, attacked so-called federal judges who ruled against him, and labeled a range of news stories and media organizations as fake news. He attacked opponents with a variety of nicknames, such as Pocahontas for Senator Elizabeth Warren, Crooked Hillary for Clinton, and Shifty Schiff for Representative Adam Schiff of California. He threatened to inflict fire and fury on Little Rocket Man, North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Trump seemed to delight in violating the rules of political correctness whenever he could. We could explain much of Trump's political brashness and destructiveness by referring to the American people's desire to disrupt the country's ossified political system, which he called the swamp. No doubt he had the good fortune in 2016 to run against Hillary Clinton. Despite her sterling resume as First Lady, Senator, and Secretary of State, Clinton campaigned terribly and made elemental mistakes, such as taking the Midwestern states of Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin for granted. If Trump had a past dogged by scandal, ethical controversies, and shady business deals, he could have found no better opponent to run against than Hillary Clinton. But Trump represented more than an anyone-but-Clinton impulse. Any of the establishment Republicans on the 2016 primary debate stage could have filled that role nicely. Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker or Texas Senator Ted Cruz would have ably carried the Republican flag into battle against Clinton. But as Victor Davis Hanson has argued, the American people wanted more. They wanted a president whose speech, mannerisms, and policies came from so far outside the political system that he might even bring down the existing political order. Trump echoes no one less than Andrew Jackson. Jackson had fought duels, owned slaves, killed Native Americans, hanged spies, and carried a lifelong hatred of both the British because of his service as a boy soldier during the Revolutionary War, and the East Coast cultural elite. He had no famous, learned, or wealthy ancestors, did not attend college, and raised himself up by the bootstraps to become the nation's savior at the Battle of New Orleans and the first president who could claim to head a popular movement. Like Jackson, Trump promised to attack the governing elites of both parties with a no-holds-barred style rather than polite debate. Populists like these usually strain at the Constitution's limits to fulfill their electoral mandates. But a funny thing happened, or didn't happen, during the Trump storm. The new president did not brandish any novel assaults on the Constitution. His opponents did. Democratic presidential candidates such as Senators Elizabeth Warren and Kamala Harris and South Bend, Indiana Mayor Pete Buttigieg, among others, called for expanding the size of the Supreme Court from 9 to 15 justices so that the next Democratic president could pack it with liberals. They have threatened to impeach Justice Brett Kavanaugh for sexual harassment claims that the Senate fully aired before voting to confirm him in 2018. In spring 2019, Democratic Senators Brian Schatz, Dick Durbin, Dianne Feinstein, and Kirsten Gillibrand introduced a constitutional amendment to abolish the Electoral College. Democratic Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez explained that the Electoral College is a shadow of slavery's power on America today that undermines our nation as a democratic republic. Progressive intellectual leaders and retiring Representative John Dingell, the longest-serving member of the House, want to abolish the Senate, too. Democrats would do even more damage to the constitutional order if they were to win the 2020 elections. They plan to implement proposals for a Medicare for All health care system that would abolish private insurance, impose federal wealth or sales taxes that violate the income tax amendment, and nationalize areas of state competence ranging from criminal justice to consumer contracts to property. Trump protected the Constitution merely by winning the 2016 election through the Electoral College, governing with the Senate, and stopping Democratic efforts to bestow vast new powers on a permanent, unaccountable bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. But Trump's defense of the constitutional order went beyond simply stopping bad ideas. His battle for the Constitution took three basic forms. First, he fought Robert Mueller's special counsel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.